sums this up in his in this one ayah, إنما يخشى الله من عباده العلماء. إنما يخشى الله من عباده العلماء. العلماء are the ones who fear Allah عز وجل the way he should be feared. Period. So when you find a person with lots of knowledge who fears the hakim, the ruler, more than he fears Allah عز وجل, that's not a alim. Period. That's not a alim. No matter what, how many fatwas he gives. Look at Ibn Taymiyyah. Then you know what a alim is. Look at Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal. You know what a alim is. Look at Imam Al-Izz bin Abd al-Salam, the one at the time of Mamalik, who stood up against all odds in order to unify the Muslim Ummah to fight the Crusaders. That's a alim. Look at those scholars or ulama who lived and died and never got a penny out of their ilm from those corrupt rulers or leaders. And I will, there are lots of things here, but we'll leave something for the discussions. I know some brothers have some issues. I'll just bring another story. That's a very interesting story from something which is, again, some of the personal stuff that I came aware of. To be very cautious from the so-called rulers, the corrupt rulers. 1966, Abdel Nasser makes the biggest bluff in the century and murder and the crime by hanging Sayyid Qutb. Sayyid Qutb is the one who wrote the in the shade of the Quran, a person who sold his life for Islam. And at the time when they were hanging him, they wanted to hang him, they brought a mufti from Azhar, or from the Dairat al-Ifta, from the Ifta, from mufti is the official scholars, official religious people. So the mufti comes in and says, oh, Sayyid Qutb, now there is a verdict against you, you will be hanged. And the rule and the regulation that I am here to ask you to pronounce al-shahadatain, to say La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah before you die. Now Sayyid Qutb, he spent all his life for La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. And this guy is coming to tell him, say La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah before you die. So Sayyid Qutb is telling him, I will. I have said this all the time, but let me tell you the difference between me and you. I say La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah and I am ready to die for it now. I am putting my neck in the rope for that word. And you are coming to earn your bread, because it's your employee, to earn your bread by saying these words. That's the difference. You eat your food by saying La ilaha illallah and I give up my life for La ilaha illallah. That's the difference between a alim and a so-called scholar for the dalal. Now, the story goes beyond. When the event took place, here is a Saudi ambassador in Jordan was complaining. The ambassador, he was a little bit upset, telling some people, some religious people, some Muslims, oh, what Abdel Nasser did was a heinous crime. It was bad. Abdel Nasser killing Sayyid Qutb, that's bad. So a person there under the name is Sheikh Tamimi, he tells him, oh, ambassador, but your government is even worse. Because in Saudi Arabia, now, as you speak, there are a few brothers that I know of who are being jailed and in jail, and you might kill them as well, just like Abdel Nasser. So what's the big deal? And this guy is telling Sheikh Tamimi, saying, who are these? I'm not aware. He said, these are members of Hizb al-Tahrir. That's why I said it's a personal story. Members of Hizb al-Tahrir were in jail in Saudi Arabia. So a few days later, the Saudi ambassador comes back to the Sheikh, tells him, well, you know, I think you are right. That's a problem. So in order to make up for this, I have arranged for a meeting to take place between King Faisal and Sheikh Nabhani, the Emir of Hizb al-Tahrir. And we are ready to release these people. Now here is the issue, is to be close to the king. Now the king is corrupt. The king is an agent of the British and the Americans. Everybody knows that. So the guy, he sends a letter to Sheikh Nabhani saying that, oh, there is an arrangement for you to meet with King Faisal. So Sheikh Nabhani ignores that altogether, he says. He doesn't even respond to the guy. After continuous pressure, then Sheikh Nabhani sends a letter to the guy, not to the ambassador. He tells him, let me give you this story. Brothers, keep up with my stories. Story leads to a story, but it's very interesting. He says, let me tell you something. My grandfather, his grandfather, Sheikh Yusuf al-Nabhani, was a judge at the time of the Ottoman Empire. Ottoman Islamic State, I'm sorry. Thank you. I thought you were sleeping. It's like you are awake. So Sheikh Yusuf al-Nabhani, the grandfather of Sheikh Taqiyuddin al-Nabhani, was a judge in the court system of the Ottoman Khilafah State. At that time, Yusuf al-Nabhani receives a letter through a messenger, a person carrying a letter. And the person carrying the letter from Ghulam Ahmed Mirza, the Ahmed Qadiani guy in Pakistan, in India. At the time, it was one big state. So the British have already installed this guy, and Ghulam Ahmed Mirza is approaching some ulama, because that was alim, approaching ulama in order to get there some sympathy. So Sheikh Yusuf al-Nabhani, now this is narrating Sheikh Taqi, saying Sheikh Yusuf al-Nabhani, he asked the person, who's the letter from? He said, from Ghulam Ahmed Mirza. He said, okay. So he grabs the letter, he throws it in the fireplace. He tells him, tell your master that Sheikh Yusuf al-Nabhani did not even read your letter, so that no one would ever say he was polluted by one of his stupid ideas. And he threw it in the fire, and your master, will be in the same place in the hellfire. Tell him that, and that's my opinion. So Sheikh Nabhani sends the letter saying that if I go and meet with Faisal, I will be polluted, and I will not get from being close to him except the sin. And he quoted the hadith for him. From Qurbihim, you get only the khataya. I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to be paid by the person. I'm not even going to be in a position where he can claim that I paid the guy. Because they can claim all types of things. So if I go at any point of time now, I say, oh, I'm going to talk to King Abdullah of Jordan privately on a private room. I want to give him a dawah. And then I come out, probably maybe I read some ayah of Quran for him. He will come out and say, oh, Abu Talha was very nice to me. I hear very good words from him. How am I going to clean that filth? So those scholars, not ulama, scholars, they do not deserve the title of a'alim until and unless. Because Allah Azza wa Jal makes an exception. He says, إِلَّا الَّذِينَ تَابُوا مِنْ بَعْدُ وَأَصْلَحُوا. Anyone who makes repentance and he makes correction, أَصْلَحُوا. فَأُولَٰئِكَ أَتُوبُ عَلَيْهِمُ وَأَنَا التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ. Thus I give them my repentance. If someone makes the correction while he's alive, the correction means what though? أَصْلَح means you correct what you have corrupted. If you have misled the people about King Fahd, during the war, remember the 1991 war? Brother Suleiman, you were there when we were at the Islamic Center. We talked about that. About the guy who made the fatwa for King Fahd to allow him to bring all the troops and to fight again. And Kalim was there too, and Ayub was, all of us were there. He gave a fatwa on this. Now, okay, you want to make tawbah? Reverse the fatwa and say, this king was oppressive and was wrong, and I was wrong in giving him the fatwa. That's what is a correction means. It's not that, oh, I did not mean it. Oh, I was under the pressure. Oh, somebody pressured me to do that. That's not correction. That's not tawbah. Tawbah, you have to make aslah. Aslah means you correct what you have
corrupted.
Exactly. إلا من تاب وأصلح فأولئك أتوب عليهم وأنا التواب الرحيم. جزاكم الله خير. There are lots and lots in the Quran, you read in the hadith, in the books of hadith about this issue of who is a alim beyond what anyone can talk about in 30 or 40 minutes. Jazakum Allahu khairan. And I will stop right here. And assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Thank you very much for the good talk. Thank you. I don't have a question, but I just have a comment. May Allah bless you for your strength and your knowledge. And I think it's good that brothers like us meet, because when we feel like we're being attacked by others, we know that our strength in Islam is important and that we stay strong. And through knowledge and defense of our Islam and by our faith, that's how we can overcome these challenges. So it's very important that we stay strong and not appease others and non-Muslims.
Assalamu alaikum. Jazakallah, brother. I was reading and checking, you know, before this lecture that we, you know, formulated that we should talk about alims. I feel that, you know, the correlation of Muslim decline is really relating to the quality of alims. When the more genuine alims, that we see the peak of Islam. As you know, the quality of alims decline, then we see that decline of the Muslims. Of course, doesn't mean that all alims finished. Like Sheikh Tabhani, as well as in Turkey, you know, Said Nursi, and as well as Sayyid Qutb. You know, these are what I call exceptions, not regular. But regular, unfortunately, regular so-called alims really misrepresented Islam and misquoted Islam. So I believe that that is our problem, one of the problems in the day that we are facing.
Right. Actually, there is a hadith. I usually quote this and I left it for this Q&A and for discussions. Hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, صَنْفَانِ مِنَ النَّاسِ إِذَا صَلُحَا صَلُحَ النَّاسِ. Two categories of people. If they are okay, then everybody else will be okay. And if they are bad, corruption will be all over. العلماء والحكام. العلماء, the one who was عالم, and the حاكم, the rulers. The rulers and those with knowledge. If they are good, everybody else will be good. Because the حاكم is the one who applies the rules, and the عالم is the one who propagates knowledge. So if knowledge is there and justice is there, what else do you want? وَإِذَا فَسَدَ فَسَدَ النَّاسِ. There is another scholar. Actually, he's a poet. He said, أيها العلماء يا ملح